knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We learned about syngas in the previous tutorial on the Fischer-Tropsch process, developed by German chemists, which involves the liquefaction of charcoal. Now let's learn about another application for syngas. Hydroformylation is the addition of syngas, which once again is hydrogen gas and carbon monoxide, to an alkene, usually a terminal one. Interestingly, hydroformylation was discovered by another German chemist, Otto Rolin, in 1938, while working at the company Ruhrchemie on further development of the Fischer-Tropsch reaction. This reaction also forms small amounts of olefins, or alkenes, and Rolin noticed that syngas was adding to these alkenes to yield aldehydes. He used a cobalt catalyst initially. As you can see, a hydrogen atom is added to one of the two olefin carbons, and a formyl group to the other. Two isomers are possible, the branched, labeled B, and the linear one, labeled L. With the initial Rolin catalyst, selectivity in favor of the linear isomer was modest, around 4-1 at best. Modification of the catalyst with phosphenes as ligands improved the selectivity to around 7 or 8-1, but still required complex fractionation of the product by distillation. The conditions used were vigorous, up to 170 degrees Celsius and 300 atmospheres of pressure. In the late 60s, better catalysts were developed based on rhodium-1. Rhodium is a much more expensive metal, but its catalysts are much more selective, with over 90% linear selectivity. They are more durable, with up to 1,000 times the number of turnovers possible than with cobalt, and much faster, so the temperatures used can be milder, under 120 degrees Celsius, and the pressures required are easier to achieve, around 15 to 25 atmospheres. The mechanism has been studied in detail and is generally similar for both cobalt and rhodium catalysts. The species 1 usually has to lose a ligand in order to enter the catalytic cycle in the form of 2. From there, the olefin coordinates to the metal center to yield 3. Then, it undergoes a hydrometallation to yield 4. This will undergo CO coordination to yield 5. This is followed by insertion of CO into the rhodium-carbon bond to give formation of acyl-rhodium complex 6. Then, oxidative addition of hydrogen gas yields 7. Finally, this undergoes reductive elimination to yield the product 8, and also regenerate catalyst 2, which enters a new cycle. The ligand has undergone major evolution over the years. Initially, triphenylphosphine ligands were used, but it was soon discovered that bidentate ligands yield better linear branched ratios. For example, butanal can be obtained in greater than 98% regioselectivity using the bidentate ligand shown here. To screen ligands, it is advantageous to start with a rhodium-1 species containing a simple group, usually acetoacetate, abbreviated as ACAC. This is activated by hydrogen gas to release acetoacetic acid while forming, upon addition of a ligand, the RHH species depicted as 2 in the scheme from before. These precatalysts make the screening of complex ligands especially convenient. This reaction is very important industrially, as the linear aldehydes are often immediately reduced to the parent alcohols, which are used in the manufacturing of detergents and other products. The output of aldehydes by hydroformylation has reached 7 million tons per year. Some companies use the cheaper cobalt catalysts, others have industrialized the more efficient and selective rhodium process. In the latter case, recovery of the metal is an essential part of the task to keep costs low. Just to give you an idea of the efficiency of this complex process, butanal is available on the ton scale for prices around $1 per kilogram. Not bad for a process using sophisticated rhodium catalysts and fancy ligands. Lately, phosphite ligands have yielded exceptional selectivities for terminal olefins. Here is an example from the labs of Steve Buchwald at MIT, where essentially complete selectivity was obtained. A specialty area is the hydroformylation of internal alkenes. If the alkene is asymmetrical, mixtures inevitably arise. In some cases, at high enough temperature and under very low CO pressures, rhodium hydride addition and beta elimination can lead to migration of the double bond faster than hydroformylation. Given that terminal olefins are hydroformylated much more rapidly than internal ones, linear products can sometimes be obtained, as in this example by Pete Van Loven, working at the University of Amsterdam. In addition to its importance in the chemical industry, hydroformylation has attracted the attention of synthetic organic chemists, which have adapted this reaction towards the synthesis of complex molecules. In addition, chemists have been fascinated by the linear selectivity of the reaction and have wondered whether, under suitable conditions, branched products can be made to predominate. The branched products are, in most cases, chiral, and therefore the possibility of enantioselective synthesis arises. One such example is from the labs of Professor Kyoko Nozaki from the University of Tokyo. She has shown that olefins substituted with polar substituents tend to give some branched selectivity, and she has been able to optimize the ligands to achieve complete regioselectivity, and in some cases excellent enantioselectivity using this ligand. In summary, hydroformylation is one of the most important processes in the chemical industry, and it is also attracting the attention of synthetic chemists, in particular those who are keen to apply enantioselective methodology to the synthesis of valuable chiral intermediates. This is still an area of current research, and new results are reported with remarkable frequency. New metals are being applied to the reaction, as well as new ligands. The number of publications in this area has reached around 300 per year, and there are multi-volume books dedicated to this topic. Thus, hydroformylation, especially due to its industrial applications, is still a huge research field.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.